Father, thank you for this beautiful afternoon. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuke and bind every foul, wicked, evil spirit. We're coming to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word will have free course in the midst of us. And out of you to say, amen. Today I want to share with you on how you can experience expanding harvest in every areas of your life. It's just to have harvest of a particular kind. No, God wants you to harvest in every area of your life. The key thing is continue to receive God's goodness and release His goodness. Remember, goodness is one of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And we're in a series called The Fruit of the Holy Spirit. And a couple of weeks ago, we talked about kindness. And last week, a week before last, talked about goodness. And goodness is the practical expression of kindness. Whereas when you hear the word goodness appear in the Bible, it's always got to do with what you do. It's your giving. It's your generosity. As a matter of fact, there are 7,000 promises in the Bible. Out of the 7,000 promises, there are 230 promises on believing. In other words, when you have faith, you have great, great, great blessing of tremendous promise. And there are 371 promises on prayer. In other words, when you pray, wow, there are great promises. And there are 714 promises on love. In other words, you're loving, you have good experience, tremendous promises. But you know, there are 2,152 promises on giving. And the key thing is, you want to experience that those promises, you got to be generous, filled with God's goodness. And the key is to receive goodness from God, and you're going to be able to release that goodness. Remember, we share on the owner of the vineyard, they have a lot of harvest and calling workers. They came at 6 o'clock, 9, 12, 3, and finally 5 o'clock, which those days it is called the 11th hour, not over an hour before nightfall. It is a picture of the 11th hour generation, the generation before Christ come. And that particular generation, all right, the 11th hour generation, when they collect their wages, the owner gave them 12 times more than the one that came in the first instant. It tells us, how many must know, you people that living in the last of the last days are going to receive amazing blessing, more than the Old Testament saints. The point I'm going to bring is, what is the key? You must understand the goodness of God. Remember, the master said to the servant that complained, how come we are receiving less? The master said, hey, are you jealous because of my uncommon goodness? The key thing, you've got to receive God's goodness and you're going to be able to release His goodness. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about the kind of a goodness that you're going to receive. Even as you plant with expectation, you're going to see increase in wisdom, you're going to see increase in the fruit of righteousness, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, prayer, partnership, and also astounding miracles. They're going to impact the next and the next and the next, even to the fourth generation. Remember, Levi was in Abraham's loins when Abraham gave the tithe. But it's regarded as if Levi has tithed to Melchizedek. In other words, how many of us you're giving impacts the next and the next and the next generation. Now, just a little bit of recap. You missed the message, get the tape. Now, today I'm going to share with you from the Word of God how you can experience expanded harvest in every areas of your life. Well, Pastor, how much of God's amazing harvest that I'm going to receive? Some people thought, well, it depends on God's law, because after all, He's God, He's sovereign. Let me tell you, the truth is that it is not really depending on God, because God said He wants to bless you with the best already. All right, He's already decided to give you the best. It depends on you. How much will you take His goodness? Remember the feeding of the 5,000? The Bible tells us that they were being fed as much as they wanted. Say it together with me, as much as they wanted. You can read that in the John 1:6-11. Now, today I want to show you how you can experience that expanding harvest by knowing how to plant your seeds and the type of seeds that you can plant. Okay, first and foremost, look at the plant, the different types of seeds, okay? In 2 Corinthians 9, verse 6.
Remember that the person who plants few seeds will have a small crop. The one who plants many seeds bountifully will have a large crop.
Notice the word many seeds and that word bountifully. In other words, if you plant just one type of seed, Your big garden, you just plant papaya, you're going to get only papaya. So when your heart is big and you want to plant different types of seed, you get to enjoy the different types of fruits. And there are different types of seeds that you can plant. Firstly, is your tithe. Malachi chapter 3, verse 10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. And test me now. In this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open to you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. Notice the first word is bring the whole tithe. Now some people like to give, oh, Pastor, tithe is 10%. I give 5% here, 2% here, 3%. No, the Bible says bring the whole tithe in the place where God has placed you and into the storehouse. Now, what do you mean by the word storehouse? Storehouse is where you are being fed and cared for. All right. How many of you eat at Kentucky Fried Chicken and walk across the road and pay at McDonald's? That's highly unusual, all right? So that's where you're being fed, you go give your tithe. Another truth that we can see in that word storehouse is that when you plant your seed, your tithe, in the local church where God has placed you, you're going to assure yourself of food for you. Food, not just in terms of that which goes into the stomach, but food in terms of the Word of God and vision. Look at the passage in Genesis 15 where that word, the Word of God, appears the first time in the entire Bible. And that word vision appear for the first time in the entire Bible. Genesis 15 verse 1.
After these things, the Word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision.
Wow, the Word of God came in a vision. And as you're going to give your tithe and put your heart in the local church, you'll find that you're going to assure yourself, because your heart is here, you're going to be able to receive the word that is in this place, and you're going to see that there's going to be word of God that's going to be preached, and you're going to stir up great vision in your life. And also, storehouse also means that this is a place where all the grains are collected, going to be able to be distributed all over the world. Like, you're not going to go to Rangoon to see the university town there, to see the opportunity. I go on your behalf. I sow on your behalf. I took a step of faith to purchase 2 lots of land for them. The reason is because the storehouse is where we gather the grain and able to channel to mission fields all over the world. But in the terms of the tithe, God say you got to give with discernment. Philippians chapter 1 verse 9.
And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment.
So it's not just a kind of a sentimental kind of a love, wishy-washy, emotional kind of love. It is got to be with discernment. It's important for us to give it discernment. This is the reason why the Bible tells us in Deuteronomy 12.
Be careful not to sacrifice your burnt offerings anywhere you please.
In other words, it's not just what you desire, what you feel. It's got to be a place where God has chosen. In our church, when we get a tithe and offering, I don't make decisions. I can recommend, I can make proposal, but our church counselor makes the final decision. Why is that important? Because how many must know there is safety in the abundance of counsel. So the church counsel makes that final decision. I can give recommendation, but ultimately, how many must know there is safety in the abundance of counsel. And when it comes to tithes and offering, you gave what you have and see what God can do. In terms of tithes and offering, how many must know that everybody can give. No matter how poor you are, how rich you are, you can give because the tithe is simply 10% what you receive. Like in the feeding of the 5,000, look at Mark chapter 6, verse 38.
How many loaves do you have? He asked. Go and see.
No, it's not so much what you don't have. God is asking you what you do have. Go and see. No matter how poor you are, I remember the poor widow that gave that 2 copper coins. Jesus was looking at the treasury, how people gave. And Jesus was amazed by the poor widow that gave that 2 copper coins. No matter what it is, no matter how poor you may be, God says you're able to give. Give what you have and see what God can do. Look at John chapter 6, verse 6.
But this he said to test them, for he himself knew what he would do.
Wow, how many times God knows what he's going to do in your life? He wants to pour out his astounding goodness and generosity in your life. The key thing is, he's testing our faith. We got to give what we do have. That's like in Malachi, test me whether I'm going to open up the windows of heaven. Now, how many have heard of Mr. Tractor? Very hard to pronounce his name. His name is Mr. Lee Twerlio. Mr. Tractor. And he was the one that God gave the ability, the creativity to invent the tractor, the big, big earth-moving machine. And he has a heart for God. He said, Lord, I want you to be my business partner. So he started to give his tithe, 10%. Then the Lord blessed him so much, he increased to 20, 30, 40. Finally, he said, one day, I'm going to make God my senior business partner. And he gave 51% and lived on 49. Then God blessed him so much, eventually he gave 90%, lived on only 10%. And towards the end of his life, he gave 100%. And how many heard of Rockefeller, John Rockefeller? He is the richest man on earth. They did a study on his legacy, amazing thing that he left behind. In 2006, his worth is $226 billion. Bill Gates, his worth is about $83 billion. So in other words, no match. But he didn't begin rich. He came from a very poor background. Mother Elijah was a very devout Baptist. But the father was a womanizer, hardly see his father. But John Rockefeller refused to let that make his life sour. Not just because you come from a very bad family background, doesn't mean that you got to be stuck in bitterness. God is able still to bless you in the most astounding way. And so God gave him creativity. A little boy, he earned something, very excited, came back to the mother. Mother, this is the amount, I want to give it to you. Mother said, have you given your tithe? And John said, hey, this is a small amount, we need the money. The mother said, give your tithe. Otherwise, I'm not going to take your money. And he gave, and God blessed him and blessed him, and God gave him tremendous creative ideas to gain wealth. In the time when nobody looks for oil field and don't see any potential in oil field. Now, of course, you know oil fields is a black gold, but those days, people don't like oil. And he purchased huge areas in Texas. And as a result of that, because of the oil price rises, he became a billionaire at age 50. And men had it, as you give your tithe, no matter how small, all right, give what you have and see what God is able to do, all right? And the tithe is just one of the many seeds, the most important seed, of course, but there are also other special offerings. An offering is something which you give over and above the tithe. Say over and above. And you can give to the building. In the First Chronicle 22 verse 5 tells us the house of the Lord must be extremely magnificent. This is why I saw the staircase, the dodgy staircase, and the pastor said, we call people to come. They heard it is the seventh floor. They don't want to come. So it's my heart's desire is to be able to rent for them a bigger premise, a nicer premise, but they have to make the decision first. We don't tell mission partners what to do. They have to decide, take that step of faith, and we pray. And I believe that God wants us to live in the best place, and other people say. Now, offering is mission offering, like we're going to do next week, a special mission offering in addition to your tithes and offering. And then, of course, we have the first fruit. We don't have the time to talk about the first fruit. Get the tape from the book counter by Rich Marshall. God had given him a special revelation on first fruit giving. Not quite sure. You can always check out with Pastor Elijah. And of course, we have love gifts. All right, love gifts is another type of seeds. All right, Pastor, so confusing, so many. Yeah, look at the rich variety of seeds that God gave us. Papaya, durian, mango, steam. So same thing about giving. There are different varieties. They're going to enjoy different types of fruit. Love gifts is among one of the types of fruits. Love gifts, for example, to the man of God. Galatians 6:6 tells us that those who are taught the word share in all good things with him who teaches. And then your household, in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8, if you don't provide for your own house, the Bible says you're worse than an unbeliever. Then, of course, in Proverbs 19, verse 17, talk about giving to the poor. All right, so these are different types of seeds. Papaya, durian. So we have tithes and offerings and special love gifts. But very important to know how to plant. All right? The Bible says plant with restful expectation. Look at James chapter 5, verse 7.
So be patient, brethren, to the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits expectantly for the precious harvest from the land. He keeps up his patience over it until it receives the early and late rains.
So for this passage, you learn a couple of things. Number one, you got to plant with grace and faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 says,
"Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they give freely willing."
So an offering is something that you give over and above the tithe. A tithe is something that you have, but offering is something that is just something that the Lord guides you and leads you. You're giving it happily and joyfully, and it's based upon the grace of God. This is why we say that when you plant with grace and plant with faith. And this is a type of offering that we are encouraging you to give this coming Sunday, which we are calling here in RLC, I think this is the only place that we use this term, which is grace, faith, giving. Say it with me, grace, faith, giving. It is an amount that you trust God to supply. Now, in many churches, they call it the faith promise offering. Nothing wrong with that term. It is not the wrong term, but just that personally, I don't quite like the word promise. Nothing wrong with the term. The term is perfectly biblical, the faith promise offering. It's just that that word promise can stir up in some people to stir them to focus on the works. Pastor, it's my sacrifice. I promise this and this and that. It draws them back to work. But it's very dangerous because the Bible says in Galatians chapter 3, those who are of the work of the law are under a curse. Now, some people, they come, Pastor, pray for this project, and I give this amount when the project is successful. Now, many of these people, in fact, I would say, all of them are very sincere in what they're doing. But sometime, in particular situation, unconsciously, even though they're sincere, unconsciously, they may refocus on their work. If God will bless me this, I'll do this. It's like work and draws them back to the human effort, the human sacrifice. So we don't want that. And so this is why we use the term sort of the faith promise offering. We call it the grace faith giving. It's based upon grace because it's not so much of what I can promise God, but what God promises. It's grace. It is tapping onto God's ability, not our ability, not what I can promise. Because God tells us that He has given us the anointing. Deuteronomy 8:18, He has given us the anointing to get wealth. We are simply tapping onto that anointing. Remember, Zechariah says, Zechariah 12 tells us, ask for rain in the days of latter rain. Say, ask for rain in the days of the latter rain. You are in the season where we're going to receive 12 times more, all right? It is the last day generation. But we still got to ask. So the grace, faith, giving, give us opportunity asking God, God, how much would you want me to give? You don't make a promise to me. Don't make a promise to anybody. You just ask God. And God will give you the strategy, the special way on how that God is going to provide you in a astoundingly supernatural way. I recall years ago, I was in Kansas City. It was an inner city black American church, relatively poor. And we were there. I didn't know that there was a building project. Now I preach on vision, decision, provision. The pastor likes the message, so duplicated those days cassette tapes. How many have seen cassette tapes? 2,000 copies. Pastor, all of the church members didn't come because of the Sunday night service. And one guy, he didn't make any promise to God. He just have a heart to give. God, I want to be part of this building project. Can you give me a way and to be able to find the supply? And God led him to a junk store, bought a book for a couple of dollars. And inside was a gold coin, which he sold, and he got $175,000. Give it to the church. So God, please give me another strategy. So the Lord led him to another junk store, bought a book, inside for another, they found another gold coin, and sold for $12,000. The pastor who wrote to me, Sheffield, he said that all in all, even through the message, vision, decision, provision. The people were stirred to believe God for big things, and God provided. They never make promises, but they asking God, ask for rain in the day of the little rain, asking God, God supply, and God supply. All in all, $2 million were collected, including a lawsuit that has been won. So in other words, Hamer must know it's grace. It's not your promise. It's not your sacrifice. It's His provision. So it is grace, faith, giving. Why faith? Because it is an act of faith, not a promise, not a vow. So if you fail in whatever that you desire to give, you don't have to make yourself feeling guilty. See, there's something about this faith promise offering. It's the meaning of a promise, and you don't fulfill it, you feel guilty, condemned. You felt you're under the curse. And how many of us know that's not biblical? The Bible doesn't want us to feel guilt and condemnation. But the kidding is an act of faith. But of course, when the money come, they'll be tempted and say, oh, pastor, this amount came. If I invest into another business venture, can give more. Ah, you got to eat up all your seeds. You're not going to be able to get the kind of harvest, expanding harvest that God wants us to have. So give with grace and give with faith. You can give your grace, faith, giving in every type of offering. You can give it through your tithe as an offering with grace and with faith to increase your tithe, because every month we've got to send supply to mission partners. Every month we've got to do that. So the tithe as an offering enabled us to do that in addition to running this church. And you can also give your grace, faith, giving in miracle seeds for the house of God and also for Mission Sunday, this coming Sunday. After the message, we're going to collect that special mission offering. Number two, God says, plant, knowing that He is your shield and exceedingly great reward. Genesis 15 verse 1.
After these things, the word of the Lord came unto Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward.
This is after he given his tithe to Melchizedek, which is, of course, a picture of Christ. After these things, God says, not I promise, not Pastor Joshua promise you this. God says, I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. Oh, Pastor, you look at the papers, there's so much uncertainty. Our exchange rate has been not very favorable. And true, there's a lot of news, bad news. But in the time of Abraham the same, when he gave his tithe, there was war, there was economic uncertainty, there was insecurity, but Abraham gave his tithe. And after he given his tithe, God says, I am your shield and your exceedingly great reward. You know, the best time to give is now. Some people say, oh, Pastor, in good time, I give. Hey, good time when you give, of course, you're going to have harvest. But bad time, all the more, we got to give. Look at Ecclesiastes 11:4.
Farmers who wait for perfect weather never plant. If they watch every cloud, they never harvest.
Wow, so you see, God wants us to give. So you can test Him to see what He can do in the midst of the toughest situation. I call the story, a pastor told me, very, very poor pastor in India. He was living in a place where there was no running water, no electricity. Next to him was a plot of land owned by a rich man. He has hundreds of cows. But he was a very miserly man, selling the milk at a very high price. But local people have no choice to buy milk from him. One day, 10 cows came over the poor pastor's house. So, of course, the owner was very upset, scolded the workers and bring the cow back. But every day the cow went. So one day, the owner said, I have hundreds of cows. Let the guy have that 10 cows. So the pastor took it as a sign from God. So he took the cow, milked the cow, and sell it to the villagers at a fraction of the price. God blesses the cow with abundance of milk, and there was a long line to get the milk. And before long, he was able to buy more cows. And after a while, the rich man could not compete with the poor pastor, sell his own plot of land at a fraction of the price of the pastor, and the pastor became the richest man in town. And all the people say, amen. So, Hamer must know God can provide you in an astounding way, even in the toughest situation. He says, I will be your shield. Not just He's going to protect you, God says He's going to be your exceedingly great reward. Number three, how to plan. They're going to get the expanding harvest. Plan happily, said the person on the right, be happy. You're going to harvest in due season. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7.
So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver.
A cheerful giver. The word cheerful is the way we get the word in English, hilarious. That means happy, joyful. You know, how many times God says, plant happily? All right, how many seen farmers when they plant the papaya? Oh, poor me, this seed could have been used to give my children. Come on, when the farmer plant the seeds, the farmer realized that it is investment. So the same way when you plant happily, joyfully, because the Bible says, in due time, you get a harvest. And but look at Galatians 6, verse 9.
And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart.
Now there's always a natural process of waiting. Nobody plant the seed and harvest at the same season. You plant a seed, you got to wait for the next season. So there's always a natural process of waiting. There's a reason why the Bible says, don't get weary, because you're going to see there's going to be the harvest. And how many of us know the harvest is going to be great? Because look at John chapter 2, we see a picture of what God is like. John chapter 2, remember the wedding and Jesus turned water into wine, John 2.
A host always serves the best wine first, he said. Then when everyone has had a lot to drink, he brings out the less expensive wine. But you have kept the best until now.
That is the way of God. God always kept the best until now. So to the right, God always keep the best until now. That's God's way. So Pastor, this year I think I'm doing good. Well, you have not yet seen what God can do the next year. Because God always keep the best until now. But the key thing is, what is the reason why they experienced the astounding miracle turning water into wine? They have invited Jesus into the wedding. Have you invited Jesus into your everyday life? Do you only talk with Jesus on a Lord's Day, Sunday? What about Monday and Saturday? You leave him out? No, you got to invite him. Partnering with you every day in your career, in your business, in your studies. And you're going to see God is going to enable you to experience the best. Every year is a better year. You think, oh man, this is record-breaking. Wait for next year. It's going to be even greater than record-breaking. And other people say, that is the way of God. Always he kept the best until now. Number four, plan resting in his enabling grace. Malachi 3 verse 11.
Then I will rebuke the devourer for you, so that it will not destroy the fruits of the ground, nor will your vine in the field cast its grapes, says the Lord of hosts. All the nations will call you blessed, for you shall be a delightful land.
God said he will rebuke the devourer. What is the devourer in your life? Maybe an unfavorable policy in your company, like this banker. Suddenly hit with an unfavorable policy, even banker couldn't get bank loan, that's astounding. Unfavorable policy, maybe unfavorable circumstances, business competitor that is unethical, maybe colleagues that is not doing right. Could be even your loved one. Certain things from you. God say he will rebuild those that devour you, steal from you, because even if you give your tithes and offering, God say he will rebuild the devourer. I remember many years ago, how many of you were with us when we were in Jalan 222, up at Forever Living Product? Put our hand, please. Ah, you were with us? How old are you? Two or three. Wow, man. This is one of the most faithful guys. Stand up, man. Look at that. 2 years old, right? When we first planted the church, I still recall there was a American lady who was on welfare, came to our church. We just planted that church. But the Lord led us to, you know, every time we could bless her in certain way. Those days, it's a pioneering time, all right? I recall that time we only have Lois leader, Joy was not born. And sometimes we have to go to the coin box to get money to buy milk. But one thing Pastor Kelly always said, we always have food in the table unless we are fasting. I remember one time when the pastor's gathering, the Lord let me to write a check, pastor to the pastor in front, and Pastor Kelly said to me, we don't have the money in the bank. But a few days later, I got a check. It was written in my name. It was exactly the amount I gave. And at times, those days, we go to the ATM machine and draw $50, $10, and it is a joy. They always say, hey, there are money in the bank. Somehow, an angel put it in. And nonetheless, in the pioneering time, we still bless this American lady that was on the welfare. But one day, she gave me an offering for my mission trip. And I couldn't take it because, you know, this lady is on welfare. I got the news also that the American authorities have stopped giving her welfare support for some reason, which I don't know. And I couldn't receive it, but I felt I need to receive. It just reminded me of the poor widow in the tomb of Elijah giving up the last ounce of bread and oil. So I took it. But I still recall she came Easter morning, beaming with joy, showing me a letter from the American government. And they say, hey, we make a mistake. We got to rectify it. What we have not given you for the past many months, even a couple of years, we will backdate it and give you that amount. And at the same time, we promise now until you die, every month without fail, we'll give you the mission support. And that letter, she showed me, and I saw it, that's astounding. And subsequently, she gave us the Bible, and we put it in the altar, and every time we move from 2 to 2 to 2 to 7, and then to here, we personally brought the Bible up there, and there was a little testimony. Just take a look at the screen, you'll see the word that she wrote. This is the Bible, and look at it. And
presented to Renewal Lutheran Church on Easter Day 1991 from Sister Eunice Bates on the occasion of her first Easter in RLC after God's major surgery at RLC, including the Power of Love Palm Sunday.
Praise God, give God a hand, come on. Cameron must know God is able to rebuild the devourer, all right? Pastor, how can you be confident that God is going to do that? Let me tell you this, He came to die for us, to bring us that restoration. Look at Psalm 69 verse 4, which is a picture. It is one of those messianic prophetic psalms that describe what Jesus did when He died for us on the cross. Look at Psalm 69 verse 4.
Though I have stolen nothing, I still must restore it.
What a beautiful picture of Christ. He didn't commit any sin, but He took our sin. He didn't steal anything, but He restored. It's almost interesting in the Old Testament time when you lost a ship. A ship, you could be restored four times. The thief is caught, he could return to you four lambs. And if you lost a bull, he could have restored five times. Something very strange. You say, how come when you lost a little animal, you get only four times, and you lost a big one, you get five. And the Lord says, the bigger the loss, the bigger the restoration. And other people say, and there's no big deal for God. Even as you come, the point is that when you come, the confidence is not in your giving. The confidence is in the fact that Christ came, died for us, all right? And if there is any delay, it's not because, well, God want to cause you a problem. It's because Hamer must know the greater the delay, the greater the loss. Hamer must know that means the greater the blessing, the greater the restoration. And other people say, and sometimes it's not God that causing the delay. It's never God. And sometimes it's the devil. Remember in the book of Daniel? Daniel prayed and God answered the prayer immediately. But there was this angel called the principality that stopped the answer. But as Daniel continued to worship and prayer, finally the breakthrough came. What is the key when you're waiting for the breakthrough, Pastor, so many months? Hey, the key thing is not God holding back. It's just their demonic operation. The key way is not complain, murmur, grumble. The key thing is keep on praising Him. The Bible says in Psalm 138, I will praise God before the gods. Not murmuring, complaining, you praise. You praise God before all this demonic activity, instead of bang, 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 you praise, keep on praise. Because as you praise, you are focusing on the goodness of God. And as the people praise, the Bible says, the land will yield its increase because you are resting in His grace. Look at the passage in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9.
For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, yet for your sakes He became poor, that you through His poverty might become rich.
How many of us know this is the full gospel? One time Dr. Cho was preaching and there's no fruit For many, many years, he fasted, he prayed, for the sick, tremendous miracle. The church never grew. So he came before God and he said, Lord, why? I'm really working hard. God said, you didn't preach the full gospel. You just tell people when they're saved, they got forgiven. You just tell people that they can be healed. But I also died, not just for their forgiveness, not just for their infirmity. I died for their poverty. I became poor that he became poor that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And other people say, he's preached the full gospel. Today, it's the largest church. There are challenges and there are problems, but the key thing is, preach the full gospel. Pastor, are you preaching a prosperity gospel? No, I'm not preaching prosperity gospel. I'm preaching the full gospel, which includes victory in every areas of our life. And other people say, amen. Of course, God is teaching, there are going to be abuses, but 100 months ago, God had given us sufficient guidelines, like in your article of the day, talk about how to overcome the challenges of prosperity in your article of the day. Lastly, plant out of gratitude and deep worship. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 4.
Consider then how great this Melchizedek was. Even Abraham, the great patriarch of Israel, recognized how great Melchizedek was by giving him a tenth of what he had taken in battle.
How many of us know when we give, it is to acknowledge how big God is? How many of us know the highest form, the greatest motivation of giving is giving out of gratitude and worship? Abraham gave, recognizing the greatness of Melchizedek, which of course is a picture of Christ. How many of us know that the highest form of giving is giving out of worship? So people ask, Pastor, can I give instead of a check? You know, nowadays, check, $1, you know. Can I send by electronic means? Can, we're not against new things. But it's nothing like when you bring your check or bring your cash in the height of our praise and worship, at the climax of the service, when we dedicate our life to God, when we hear testimony of the goodness of God, and we give out of worship and drop your offering in the offering bag in the highest moment of the worship service as an act of worship. Don't save that $1. All right? Of course, you're outstation when they do that, fine. But I think giving out of worship expresses gratitude, because gratitude gives you wholeness. Remember the 10 lepers they were healed? Only one came back and gave thanks to Jesus. And look at what Jesus said to the guy that came back. Look at Luke chapter 17, verse 19.
And he said unto him, arise, go thy way, thy faith hath made thee whole.
10 people got healed, but only one person was made whole. Wholeness, not just prosperity, but emotional wholeness, spiritual wholeness, relationship wholeness in every areas of our life. There was this guy that brought his son to McDonald's to buy a packet of French fries. And while driving, he reached out to the French fries and started to eat. The guy's son said, no, Dad, this is my French fry. Now, when that happened, the guy that was driving had 3 thoughts in his mind. He said, I am the source of his fries. Without me, he would not be enjoying the French fries. I can take all, number two, I can take away all the French fries because I am the daddy. I own the fry because I bought it with my money. And then thirdly, he said, I don't really need his French fries. I have money to buy tons of fries. Why he want that son to give? Because he wants his son. One of the greatest gifts you can teach your children is giving. I want my son to have gratitude because it's going to make him whole. Why do you think your pastor preached on giving? 2 Sundays, expounding on the word goodness. I don't like to teach on giving, but I felt if I don't, I'm going to rob you of an opportunity to be made whole. And gratitude makes us wholesome. It's going to affect every areas of your life, in your relationship with your spouse, your children, in your colleagues and friends. It's going to make you wholesome. Lastly, gratitude releases special intimacy with God and His heart, in addition to wholeness. We talk about John Rockefeller. He became a multi-billionaire age 50. But one day the doctor said, you got only 1 year to live. How many of you would feel something on the inside? Maybe some of you feel sober. Got 1 year to live. His health degenerated. He couldn't sleep. But he didn't make that to salvage his life. He continued to give with tremendous sense of gratitude. To cut the story short, he lived to 100 years of age. He testified, the reason I live to 100 years of age is because of that giving that come out of worship and a heart of gratitude. He served, despite the news, all right, he got 1 year to live, continued to serve. He was a janitor of the church. Can you just imagine the billionaire serving in the enviro ministry? Cleaning the toilets. Serve in the children's ministry, helping and giving. Continued to give. He founded the University of Chicago and built a very huge university in the Philippines. And all in all, in his life, he gave $5,000 million. That's astounding. And he said, I attribute my recovery, wholeness, because of that giving out of gratitude. And it draws you, that giving out of gratitude draws you in a special way to God and His heart. Remember the story of Joseph? Joseph is a beautiful picture of Christ. Remember Joseph was rejected by his brethren. And Jesus was rejected. And Joseph feed the hungry in the time of famine. Jesus fed us in all our needs. What did the brother came to back grain in the height of famine? And they saw Joseph, they didn't recognize Joseph. But Joseph said, hey brothers, I am Joseph whom you sold. They panicked. They look at this guy who is now the prime minister. They are fearful. But Joseph said to his brothers, do not be afraid. Come near me, and I will put you in Goshen, which is the best part of Egypt in a time of famine. Friend, in the midst of all the uncertainty, read the paper, all the unfavorable economic situation, let me tell you this. The key is draw near to Jesus, and Christ will put you in the best of the land. And the kidding is drawing near. The word Goshen actually in the Hebrew means draw near. Yeah, you make bad choices, like Joseph's brother make bad choices. But don't run away from God. Even when you make bad choices, stupid choices, bad decision, draw near to Jesus. What is the key to draw near to Jesus? I believe one of the keys is giving. Because when you give, you are close to the very heart of God. That's what Jesus Christ said. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart going to be. Matthew 6:21.
For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
See, when you're a giver, you really are close to His heart. You understand His purpose. But look at a place like in the West Wing Yangon University. You're not going to say, oh, another challenge and giving. You're going to say, hey, great opportunity now. Because you understand God's heart. You want to give the best. And you, in a very unique way, are drawn close to God in a very special way. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, we got to close.
So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver.
So Pastor, I'm confused. I thought you say God so loved the world. Everybody is loved. Yeah, God so loved the world. But I don't understand it perfectly, but I do know one thing. Yeah, God so loved the world in a general way. But God loves a cheerful giver in a very uncommon way. Man, when you have His heart, when you're close to His heart, understand really what giving is, man, you will feel that special love that God has. in a very unique way that I just couldn't understand a phantom, because you're going to understand his heart, you're going to understand his purpose. And other people say,
the Lord Jesus Christ said, who then is the faithful and wise steward whom his master will make ruler over his household?
I'm glad to be made ruler
of God's household resources. That's an astounding privilege. And the key thing is, whom the master make ruler over his household to give them the portion of food in due season. A faithful and wise steward.
God is looking for wise. The word wise means alert.
Opportunity come, we lay hold.
All right? And be sensitive. Not just wishy-washy kind of a love. All right? But really love with discernment. Wise and faithful. Faithful means also full of faith.
And we're looking forward to Sunday, the Mission Sunday offering. We believe that God can raise up capital amount that enable us to support mission partners for their capital requirement.
Of course, we need faith, grace, faith giving for our tithes and offering also, because we're increasing our mission partners all the time. And so every month, tithes and offering, we need to increase so that we can give. Monthly support also. They don't live on fresh air and sunshine. They need the monthly support for the children, etc., running of the church, but capital amount as well. So you can give your grace, faith giving for your tithes and offering, for the miracle seed, and also, of course, mission giving. And God is saying, who's going to be the ruler of my resources that I can pour in? The key thing is, God is looking for faithful and wise steward. Are you going to be the one? It's coming Sunday, looking forward to that. And we can be faithful because Jesus was that faithful guy who came, died for us on the cross. You know that God loves you so much, so much, so much. He came down in human form. The Son of God. What does that mean? It simply means the only one in world history that have the very gene of God. He came for one purpose, to take on him, his body, the destructiveness of sin. He hates sin. He loves you. In fact, he came down. He loves you. But he hates it because he knows that sin can destroy you, your life, your relationship. But he loves you so much, he cannot bear to see you suffering in that destruction that sin caused. He gave up his life. He died. You know why? He loves you. He wants to bear all your burdens, all your misery, all your pain. You say, Pastor, I want to know more about Jesus. I want to receive what he has done. I would love to pray for you. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus Christ to die for me on the cross. You took the destruction, the penalty that I deserve, that I may receive what Jesus Christ deserves. Thank you for loving me so much, willing to die for me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
If you have said that prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to us.